Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful, respected viewers, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brothers and sisters in Islam, may the peace and blessings of Allah be upon you. Welcome to the 12th episode of the Treatise of Rights series. Today we will talk about the right of the wife. Regarding this, the Imam Sajjad Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam has said, "And the right of your subject through matrimonial contract is that you should know that God has made her a repose, a comfort, and a companion and a protector for you. It is incumbent upon each of you to thank God for the other and realize that the other one is God's blessing for you. It is mandatory to be a good companion for God's blessing and to honor her and treat her gently. Yet your right over her is more incumbent, and she must obey you in every matter that you like or detest, except in acts of disobedience to God. She should enjoy the rights of mercy and intimacy, as she is an object of tranquility. You should care for her through consummation of the lust that must be consummated, and that is surely great, and there is no power but in God. When an individual decides to get married, they must take into consideration a number of factors. Deciding to get married is of great magnitude, therefore one must be extremely vigilant and attentive to even the smallest detail and actions taken by him. Marriage is a blessed foundation of a family. The husband and wife make a promise to each other that this relationship would last to the end of their life. This structure is not built using bricks, steel rods, and cement. It is a home built upon love, comfort, and delight, in which the couple shall live together their whole life and raise boys and girls to continue the human society. We shall remind you that this structure is only firm if the husband and wife know about what Islam has set forth as rightful decrees. Otherwise, this structure will be shaken up by the erupting quakes of disharmony and bad temper. God has considered the creation of man and woman and their dwelling together as signs in the Holy Quran. And among his signs is this, that he created you from mates from among yourselves, that ye may dwell in tranquility with them. And he has put love and mercy between your hearts. Verily, in that are signs for those who reflect. The Holy Quran, Al-Rum, verse 21. Deciding to start a family and get married is greatly encouraged in Islam and perceived as a concept very holy. The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, says, "No house has been built in Islam more beloved in the sight of Allah than through marriage." On another occasion, the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, and his holy progeny said, "The best people of my nation, Ummah, are those who get married and have chosen their wives, and the worst people of my nation are those who have kept away from marriage and are passing their lives as bachelors." Imam Ali, peace and blessings be upon him, exhorts, "Marry because marriage is the tradition of the Prophet." The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, and his holy progeny also said, "Whosoever likes to follow my tradition, then he should know that marriage is from my tradition." Various studies prove that married people remain healthier physically and mentally. Islam has always maintained that marriage is beneficial for us in many ways. Islam also regards marriage as a way to acquire spiritual perfection. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him and his pure family, said, "One who marries has already guarded half of his religion, therefore he should fear Allah for the other half." The Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him, also said, "Two rak'ats, cycles, prayed by a married person are better than 90 vigil and the fast of a single person." The first characteristics mentioned by Imam Sajjad are tranquility and dwelling in love. God subhanahu wa ta'ala has considered the creation of man and woman and their dwelling together as signs in the Holy Quran. And among his signs is this, that he created you from mates from among yourselves, that ye may dwell in tranquility with them. And he has put love and mercy between your hearts, verily in that are signs for those who reflect. The Holy Quran, Ar-Rum, verse 21. The issue of dwelling together in love is also stated in the following verse. "It is he who created you from a single person and made his mate in order that he might dwell with her in love." The Holy Quran, Al-A'raf, chapter 7, verse 189. The two concepts of tranquility and dwelling together, which are major God-given blessings, are presented in these verses. This includes physical and spiritual, as well as individual and social aspects of tranquility and mutual life. No one can deny the physical ailments due to not marrying. Everyone is familiar with the spiritual problems and psychological disturbances that unmarried people have to deal with. Unmarried people feel less social responsibility. This is why more cases of suicidal attempts are seen among unmarried couple. They also commit more crimes. A person who gets married is no longer single. He discovers a new character within himself and feels a lot more responsible. When a couple's life is filled with tranquility, love, and mercy, it is then firmly established. On the contrary, if these elements were to be taken away, without a doubt, this couple will lead a very shaky and fragile relationship. Marriage is like the first level of social life. Through marriage, one can study and learn about the rights. Time for a quick short break. Stay tuned. There are two kinds of rights established between a couple, legal rights and moral rights. The legal rights include the right that the husband must feed and clothe his wife and provide for her shelter. They also include the right that the woman should obey her husband. These rights are the fundamentals of mutual life and are needed in order to provide for life, just like the foundation and the structure of a building. However, moral rights are those which both the husband and the wife are morally bound to adhere to. Should they not adhere to these rights, there is no legal obligation for them to do so. However, the beauty and pleasure of life is dependent upon performing these duties. Acts like compliance, friendship, and love fall in this category. One can consider these rights as the decorations of life, such as painting and fine plastic work. The law of creation has made men and women in need of each other in order to better unite men and women together and strengthen the family, which is the main basis of human prosperity. If men have been established as the ones for the women to financially rely on, women have been created for men to spiritually rely on. These different needs attract them to each other and finally unite them. As with everyone else, a wife and a husband have their own unique rights that Allah has given them. The rights of wives and husbands are completely described in the glorious Holy Quran. When studying them, one can recognize these mutual rights as being one of the miracles of the pure culture of Islam. No other school of thought has so thoroughly attended to the rights of the wives and their husbands until now, and none can do so from now until the end of time. These rights include obligatory and recommended rights. Disrespecting the mandatory rights without the other person's consent is the cause of divine punishment, and not honoring the recommended rights will lessen the sweetness of life. Isaac, the son of Amak, said that he had asked Imam Sadiq, peace and blessings be upon him, what right does a woman have whose fulfillment by her husband implies that he is a good doer? The Imam, peace and blessings be upon him, replied that he should feed her properly and provide her with clothing, and when she does something out of ignorance, he should forgive her. Then the Imam, peace and blessings be upon him, said, my father had a bothersome wife, but he would always forgive her. The sixth Imam quoted the Prophet sallallahu alaihi as saying, Gabriel recommended on behalf of wives so much so that I thought divorcing her is not permissible unless she commits adultery. He also said, good mercy be upon the man who performs all the affairs for himself and his wife well, since the God Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted to men the control of women and established the husband as her guardian. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi has said, one who ignores his wife's rights is deprived of God's mercy. He also said, the best of you is one who is the best for his family, and I am a model for you in this regard. As for the wife, Islam has given her many rights. These include for the man to provide a living for her. The Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, said, one must provide the foodstuffs and clothing of his wife in the best manner. Imam Al-Sajjad, peace and blessings be upon him, said, going to the market and buying one dirham of meat which my wife desires is better than freeing a slave. The sixth Imam said, the most fortunate man is the one who manages the affairs of his wife and children. A wife deserves to be respected and honored. She deserves someone to speak to her in a calm and respectful manner. Swearing or using any vulgar language will force the person we are facing to react no matter who they are. When you complain too much, your wife will be upset, and this will ruin your mutual life. The Commander of the Faithful, Amir al-Mu'mineen, peace and blessings be upon him, has ordered men, be patient with your wife under all circumstances and treat her with kindness. A major factor in strengthening the ties of mutual life is dependent upon the woman respecting her husband's rights. The wife should only consider God subhanahu wa ta'ala and hereafter, and not let anyone else interfere in regards to her husband's rights. Others may be mistaken or have bad intentions, and it may even be that the case of such interference in the life of the newlywed couple is pure jealousy. Women should remember that they are easily influenced by others. They should consider this element of their nature and pay close attention to the possibility of others being wrong. They should remember God subhanahu wa ta'ala and their situation in the hereafter and respect the man's humane, divine, and religious rights. The seventh Imam, peace and blessings be upon him, said, "A woman's jihad is to take good care of her husband. A woman's jihad is being grateful to her husband, being kind with him, bearing with him when he is poor, seeing him off when he leaves, and welcoming him when he comes home, totally submitting to her husband at allowed times, putting on good clothes and makeup for him, properly running the affairs of the house, avoiding wastefulness, and not asking him for more than he can buy." Such acts, which are defined by the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him and his holy progeny, and the Imams as a wife's duty towards her husband, are her jihad, or the holy war. We have reached the end of this episode. Stay tuned for the next episode of the Treatise of Rights series. May Allah hasten the reappearance of our beloved Imam Mahdi, peace and blessings be upon him. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.